Good morning, Grandview. As you guys are standing for worship this morning, yes, it's time to stand, time to worship God. As you guys are standing for worship this morning, I just want to encourage you that you serve a God who is always present. I know during the Christmas season, it's a lot easier for us to acknowledge that. We talk about the birth of Christ. We talk about how he came to this earth. But especially, I want you to remember that in every season, in every moment that we serve a God who is not only present, but we serve a God who is good.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. And let the king of my heart be the shadow where I run, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. 'Cause you are good. You're good. Be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the
just thank you for your presence. Lord, right now, we just thank you for the Holy Spirit who is here with us. Lord, thank you for the reminder of your presence in our life, that you are a God that will never leave us, you will never forsake us. May there be a spirit of courage, faith, and bravery that comes a part of your church as we remember the Lord is with us and you are faithful to bring goodness and your will to pass in our lives. Lord, we just thank you that you're never on trial in our life. Your faithfulness is something that we trust, and we will depend upon you regardless of what goes on in our life. So, Lord, thank you for being a good God. Thank you for helping us in things that we're facing, problems that are stressing us out right now, situations that we don't know what to do or how to fix it. We thank you that we are aware of your presence in our life. And you're a good God, and you're able to bring your will to pass in our life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Just pivot to a couple people right around you and just tell them God is able before you're seated. God is able. Just tell them God is able. God is able. Just let a couple people right around you. That's why it's good to sit by someone. Just tell them God is able. Just a couple of quick things that we want to just bring to your attention, then we're going to just rush right back into worship. First of all, just want to just remind you, the scripture says in Romans chapter 8, verse 25, out of the Living Translation here, it says, but if we hope for what we don't see, we wait for it with patience. And I know that Pastor makes you do this a lot, and it's just because I need you to get stirred up on the inside of you. But with a smile on your face, just turn to someone and say, wait for it, wait for it, wait for it, wait for it. We wait for it with patience. Well, I was reading that scripture in my devotions the other morning, and all day long, I just kept hearing the Holy Spirit say, just wait for it, just wait for it. Having that spirit of expectation coming alive on the inside of us, and believing what God can do, that what we see doesn't mean God's done yet. And I ran across a saying the other day, an individual mentioned, delay does not mean denial when we're following after God in our life. And so I hope that you're already starting to get the spirit of faith stirred up on the inside of you, because God wants to do some incredible things in our lives. And if we are not waiting with expectation, or if we stop at this moment and because we haven't seen it come to pass, we give up on God, then it's oftentimes we've stopped the plan of God from fulfilling in our life because our faith stops God from moving in our life. And so we're just going to keep waiting for it, wait for it, wait for it, wait for it. You know, this morning there's several people that I've already made comments about how old your pastor is getting, and just already making some expectations. And I just expect everybody who makes a comment about my age is aware that my birthday is coming, so something good's going to come out of this. Something good evidently is going to come out of it. So, but we have a good God, and he wants to do good things in our lives. And I just want to remind you that as we are in a season of expectation, if God could do what he did 2,000 years ago with the coming of a Messiah through a virgin woman, he can do anything in our life today. Amen? I said amen. That's right. That's right. He's a good God. And with that, I want to just say thank you to those that have decorated the church. And even though, really, we don't know the exact day that Jesus was born. I mean, we struggled to get it down to the year that he actually was born. But we know that he did come. And we're just celebrating with expectation the coming. There was a day that a virgin gave birth to the Messiah, the Savior of the world. And we're just like celebrating and thankful for that in our lives. And so just want to say thank you for those that came and spent the extra time decorating here in the church. We appreciate that immensely. Also want to say thank you. We had a couple extra youth that today were serving at the door, greeting them when they come in. Make sure that you greet them also, and maybe even as we're doing things like that, ask them what their name is. I challenge you, start to learn their names and to be able to tell them thank them for what they're doing. Only announcements that we have really coming up here is the ladies' event is coming up here on December 11th. We got that right from, no, it's, we still have December 11th. Are you here? Lisa, 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 step into the light just a little bit more. Lisa, come on over. Let everyone know who does the announcements around here, because it's the pastor is the one. No, Lisa does a fabulous job, and I should have known that already. Yeah. We should make one of those church bloopers where we do things. How many of you now remember when the date is because of the mistake that I made twice in a row here on that? But Thursday is the event, and it's coming up this Thursday. So please be here, ladies. We're going to serve right at 6 o'clock. And so come early if you would. Be here, be ready at 6 o'clock this Thursday evening. If you haven't paid Marilyn, please do that so today. Take care of that. If you have any questions on the event that you've signed up for there, see Marilyn if you would, please. Also then next Sunday, December 10th, that is next Sunday. And it's going to be down in the fellowship hall. We encourage you to come 9:15 to 10. We're going to have breakfast down there for you. So we encourage you to come be a part of that. And as we said, eat and then rotate. Have your breakfast and then take a cup of coffee or whatever and move around to different tables and get to know one another there. It's just a great time for us. So I encourage you to be there and be a part of that. Caitlin's got a quick announcement here just on some of our student ministry resources that are available.
Good morning. I'll just stand right here. You guys can still see me. I'm the person in the red shirt. One of the questions that we've been asked is what kind of resources can people's children and youth be using outside of the church to be able to continue to grow different Bible studies, different devotionals that work well for kids? So what we have seen, there's obviously the YouVersion app. That's free to download. You can download that. If you click on the plans tab, there are actually plans that are catered to both children and youth. So you can find plans for them. There are daily devotionals. It has scripture. Sometimes it has videos, and sometimes it has songs that you can go to as well. So the YouVersion app is a great one. My personal favorite is actually the Bible Project app. This is also a free downloadable app. It's crowdfunded. It's very, very cool. The Bible Project app actually has some more layers to it. What's neat about the Bible Project app is that it has led devotionals so that you can have some led scripture reading. It also has videos that do a very nice job of explaining different biblical concepts. It is catered to people of all ages. I have adults that enjoy using the Bible Project app just as much as kids and youth that enjoy using it. And then if you're somebody that likes to test your knowledge and make sure that you're understanding, it also has some reading comprehension quizzes that are a part of it that you can also click on as well. So if you do not have the YouVersion app downloaded or the Bible Project app downloaded, I do encourage you. I know a lot of kids have access to devices. They've got tablets. They have phones. Have them download those and have them start working through some of those devotionals. There is an endless supply of resources within those two apps, and that should definitely be enough to help guide some scripture reading on their free time.
Let's all stand. As we enter into this Christmas season that we're in, let us remember that Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us. Amen. He never leaves us and he never forsakes us. He's with us always, even to the ends of the earth. Hallelujah. Jesus.
Has been given the King of our freedom. Sing for the light has come. This is Christmas. Come and adore him and bring gifts before him. Worship the sun. This is Christmas. This is Jesus, Emmanuel, here with us. Tell all the world we have a Savior. We have a Savior. We are no longer lost, but
Savior, name above all names. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you for the name of Jesus.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. Didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you great, your love was great. Never cease to worship.
need an atmosphere of faith, people, believers releasing their faith in what God can and will do in their lives. We need to come into an atmosphere where we're expecting the Holy Spirit to touch lives. Folks, I just want to remind you today that for every problem that you have, God has a way through in your life. And so I'm just asking for a few moments for us to be able to release our faith with one another around us. If you're here today and you're saying, Pastor, I've got a situation that I don't know how to get through it, but I'm trusting God. But I would appreciate some extra prayers and faith to be joined together with us. We pray one for another. Amen. And so if you're here today and you're just saying, Pastor, I got a problem, I got a situation, I don't see the way through, I'm trusting God, but I'd just like some others just to agree with me. Just raise up your hand just real quickly. We can pray one for another. Look around for those that are right around you, or if you feel led of the Spirit to move out to somebody, maybe they don't even have their hands up. Maybe they have gotten to the place where they are so discouraged that their hands can't even go up. But you feeling led by the Holy Spirit can put your hand upon them and will ignite on the inside of them that spirit of faith, the stir on the inside of them. So just start to pray one for another. Start to believe God to work in their life. God is the way maker. Pray that He would reveal Himself to them. Reveal the way that He has for them. Reveal the direction He's got for their lives. Stir up on the inside of them that spirit of faith that they know God has not left them. God's not forsaken them. Don't get their eyes on what is. Get their eyes on the God who is able to do all things. He is still the miracle worker today in Jesus' name. So start to pray for one another like you would want someone to pray for you in this situation. Start to pray one for another and release your faith in God's grace to work supernaturally in their lives. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, we come together as the household of faith. We come together as a spiritual family that we shoulder things together. Lord, we may not know exactly what this individual is going through. We may not know what they're facing. Lord, to us it might not seem like a big deal, but for some reason in their life they don't see the way. Thank you for being the way maker in their life. Thank you for revealing yourself to them right now in Jesus' name. Thank you for the presence of the Holy Spirit stirring upon them, coming upon them, and filling them afresh with that spirit of joy and hope in believing in what God is able to do supernaturally in their lives. We pray one for another and stir up the gifts that you put in our lives. And we speak words of encouragement, exhortation, and comfort over them. We allow the Spirit of God to speak through us, to touch them with words of faith that will build their lives and trust in your miracle working power. God, we might not see it come to pass today. We might not see it come to pass this week. We might not see it come to pass yet this year, but we believe that there is a way through and that you're going to lead them, guide them, provide for them, protect them, and show them what you want to do. And you'll get all the glory along the way as we follow after you in Jesus' name. And so, Father, we just ask. We ask in the miracle working power of the name of Jesus. We ask that you would be gracious in their life and reveal to them the way out of the situation that they're in to bring glory to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now let's act like we believe there's a God that hears and answers our prayers. Give someone a hug, a handshake, a pat on the back. Do something to let them know that you believe that God is able to work supernaturally in their life. That you believe that God is able to move and manifest Himself through their lives. It's a good place to be in church, amen, as we come together and see what God's doing. And I say, well, Pastor, everything's great with my life. That's a great time to come to church. Because I can guarantee you not everybody is as in good a shape as you are. But we can help one another. We should encourage one another. Build faith up in one another. Amen. I said amen. Amen. Amen's not a hard word to say. Just go ahead and say it. I encourage you today as we're endeavoring to break the sound barrier. Because we need to release those shouts of joy. We need to be crying out to the Lord with a loud voice. It's just to say amen in church today. Go ahead. Nobody's going to haul you out. It's all right. And every time you say it, just say it a little bit louder. Turn to your neighbor and say, just get a little louder. Just get a little louder. Just get a little louder. A little louder. Everyone say that, except if you got kids, don't do that one there. Oh, no, no. No, it's important for us to come together, just like with breakfast next week. I was so encouraged when we started talking about breakfast, not just the ones of you that are going to be there and signed up and going to show up, but those that pray normally at 9, they said, well, what are we going to do? And I was so encouraged that they said, well, we'll just come at 8. Isn't that great? That they didn't say, oh, well, we'll take the day off. They said, no, we'll just come an hour earlier. We'll just be here an hour earlier. So there's still going to be prayer next week at 8 o'clock. So we just appreciate those that have that commitment to come. And over in the education building, just go on over there at 8 o'clock, pray. Then when you go down and eat, you'll be even more filled. You'll fill your spirit and your body. And so we encourage you, 8 o'clock next week, prayer over in the education building there. Then go on downstairs, 9:15. We'll be breakfast, just sitting down there ready for you to be served. And then after church next week, we do have a members meeting. I encourage you to come and for members to be a part of that. It'll be just a short members meeting right after service next Sunday, just to the proposed budget. So please be aware of that and be at all of those. And I just want to say thank you for those that are coming Wednesday night. Appreciate your presence here coming and sharing the things. And I was encouraged after Wednesday night, Kathy had come up to me and I'd use the illustration of fine china. If you flick it, if it sings, it tells you that it's real crystal. And Kathy came up afterwards and she talks about some of the places she goes. And even she said earthenware, if you flick it, if it's got a flaw in it or an air pocket, and it will have a different sound, it won't sing. And so many different areas of our life. And folks, on Wednesday nights when we come, I know you've had many of you a long day and things that are going on, but it was just a good encouragement and remind us that we as believers, when we get flicked, we're going to sing thanksgiving to God in our life. Not because we've been hit, but because we're just fine china. Amen? We haven't got any flaws in the sense that we've got the greater one on the inside of us. And I've just been encouraged with that illustration this week just in my life. And I want you to know that as pastor, as we look at these series like this spiritual power of thanksgiving, that it's not just a November message that's easy to put together. But I really sense the impression of the Holy Spirit to encourage us to be able to share along these lines so that we can be doers of the word and not hearers only. That's a quiet amen. The next one's going to get a little louder, all right? That we are encouraged to be doers of the word, to apply the spiritual principles of God's word into our life, to be able to go from not necessarily to heights of glory, but to go to depths of revelation of the application of God's word. I thought it was interesting, and this week I ran across and the understanding that there's a new phobia that they have listed out there. There's a new phobia. I was kind of surprised that they had labeled it, but I guess I'm not surprised that it's there. It's homiliophobia. You can go online and see it. It is the fear of sermons. Some people, just thinking about hearing a sermon, will get nervous, and even some to the extreme that they'll panic. Folks, I want you to know that sometimes that phobia is because people realize that they need to change to line up to the truth, and that we need to be open, that we're not afraid of the truth, but we want to be transformed by the truth. Can I get an amen out of that on that one? And so I hope none of you have any of that phobia of sermons. If so, we believe in casting out. And so we'll get that out of you so you can receive the word of God in your life. And we'll be able to grow more and more along the way. And I just, because it's so important, folks, because if we're afraid to hear the word, then we will hinder our faith, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We've got to constantly keep ourselves stirred up in our lives, because here's something I want you to think about. You might want to write this one down, because today I want to take a biblical example And I want to take it and merge it with a spiritual truth in our life. We'll take a biblical example and we're going to merge it with a spiritual truth in a minute here. But God can, listen to me, God can not only change bad things into good, he can take good things and he can make them great. Sometimes we get content in our walk with the Lord to just, if he would turn this bad situation around to a good one, but I want you to know that God can take good and he can take it to great if we'll keep following after him. And this spiritual force of thanksgiving is one of those releases of our faith in what God is still doing. Just because it's better than it was doesn't mean you've got to stay there. We can still trust God that he's working. And if he could get us to this point, he can take us on to a better than where we're even at right now in Jesus' name. He can turn things around, not just so that the bills are paid. He can take us to the point that he can bless us above what we could ever think or imagine in our life. He can take us to the point that we can not just sleep at night. He can give us peaceful rest even when we're awake in our life. He can help us so that we can have the peace of God that surpasses all natural understanding, that you don't have to listen to a cassette tape, that really aged me, didn't it? You don't have to listen to something on the internet of the sounds of rain coming down, but you can listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit that gives you peace in your life. I'm not opposed to some of these external things. They're good. I'm just saying God is great in our lives. And I want to stir you up today that we are thankful for the good things that the Lord has done. But I'm just believing that there's a miracle working God that can take us to great things in our life if we'll keep our faith alive in him. You know, the Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Corinth and in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. If you want to turn there, you can. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. Now, I'm still talking about thanksgiving, but I'm always wanting to remind us that whatever we do that's going to be pleasing to God, there has to be an element of faith involved in it. Now, if I was to start handing out $100 bills here today, I'm sure that many of you would be thankful along the way. And you'd be thankful for what I have done. But if I'd say, come back next week, and I'm going to be passing out $1,000 to everybody that comes, oh, would there be a fresh joy of expectation in people's hearts, wouldn't there? Huh? We'd be here next week, wouldn't we? We'd be here early, like some folks today for a Christmas gift came 15 minutes early to church today. It was incredible. But I want you to know that God is able to work in our lives. He wants us to be thankful for what he has done, but with the element of faith, I want us to be thankful for what he's still going to do in our lives. That we have a spirit of expectation about us. We can trust God. We can trust God. Even when we don't see it, we can trust God. Even when we don't see him working it out, we can still trust God. Here in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16, I don't often read from the Message translation, but I thought this was just kind of brought it out in a different way for us today. So here in 2 Corinthians 4, 16 and 18, listen to this. So we're not giving up. So we're not giving up. So we're not giving up. Can I get an amen out of you on that one? So we're not giving up. How could we? Even though on this outside, it might look like things are falling apart on us, on the inside, God is making new life. Not a day goes by without his unfolding grace. These hard times are small potatoes compared to the coming of his grace. These hard times are just small potatoes, he said, compared to the coming of his good times, the lavished celebration prepared for us. There's far more here than meets the eye. The things we see now are here today and gone tomorrow, but the things that we can't see will last for forever. With this attitude of thanksgiving that we've been talking about, coupled with this truth that God is working even when we can't see it, that there should be a sense of expectation in our life that not only is he working in us, but regardless of, even if it looks like in our life where things are falling apart around us, we've got a God that can still work all things together for good in our lives. And as believers, we must make sure that we're keeping that stirred up in our lives. If David in the Old Testament could go to God 10 times a day. Now, I know many of you are very busy individuals. I know several of you are very important individuals. But David, King David, was able to take 10 times a day, 10 times that he would go and get away and separate himself and be with the Lord. The interesting thing is that when he would take 10 of those times and go and be with the Lord, 7 of those 10 times, he intentionally gave thanks to God. Isn't that interesting? That he did twice as much thanking God than asking God for things to go on. And I'm sure that he had a lot of things to ask about. I'm sure you've got a lot of prayer requests to go to God. But what would happen if you made sure that you did twice as much thanking God for his promises and what he's going to do in your life than praying to God about what's going on in your life? I just wonder if that spirit of faith on the inside of us would start to transform and to change the way we see what we're facing. We've already seen that Thanksgiving releases the delivering power of God. The children of Israel in the Old Testament, there in 2 Chronicles 20, where they started to praise God and thanked him for his mercy and his goodness, sent the worshipers out ahead, and because of that, God brought deliverance into their lives. We've seen that Thanksgiving releases the miracle power of provision, where Jesus himself took the little that he had, the bread and the fish, and he gave thanks to God and started to then give the little that he had away, and God multiplied it back into his life. Jesus did it, we can do it. But we've got to do it with an attitude of faith, not just trying to do the exact works that he did. We've got to have an attitude of faith on the inside of us. Today, I just want to go just one step further. And I want to just look at, again, a biblical example of a spiritual principle of how God wants to bring completeness and wholeness to your life. Turn with me, first of all, to our text, 1 Thessalonians 5. 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 16 through 19. It's incredible in such a small portion of text, such a small chapter, verses in this chapter, that God can bring so much to challenge our lives with. Here, Paul is writing to the church and encouraging them on a way that they should be living their life. I don't mean this in any kind of a condemning way or trying to just be in a religious commandments or whatever, but these verses are not options. This is a way of life that is expected for the new believer, the one who is really believing that God's doing more in me than what you can even see on the outside. That regardless if life is falling apart around me, that there's something incredible that's going on that is by God on the inside of me that's happening. The Apostle Paul is writing here, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 through 19. The New Living Translation says, always be joyful, never stop praying, be thankful in all situations, for this is God's will for you who belong to Christ Jesus. Do not stifle the Holy Spirit. I have to believe that if we are joyful, if we are praying, if we are thankful, that we're not stifling the Holy Spirit. But these verses work in reverse also. You will be stifling the Holy Spirit in your life if you're not being thankful, if you're not praying, and if you're not being joyful. Now again, speaking of the age of which I'm maturing to, when I was in school, we were given letter grades. Anybody remember letter grades? I remember some of, you can tell me thanks, because my group in school made it possible for you upper achievers to be able to get the percentage that you got. And so you can think about that later. But anyway, in school, you got an A, a B, a C, a D, And some of us even were just fabulous along the way in different ways. But you got a grade, math, social studies, you got a grade, even PE, physical education. If you didn't, to us at that time, that just meant if you didn't dress out, if you didn't show up, then you failed along the way. There wasn't a whole lot of education that went on. It was just participation more than anything else. You could get an A in math. You could get an A in social studies. But if you didn't participate in PE, you got an F. And it affected your grade point average. Now, there were some people that were very upset with that. Some of us appreciated getting that grade in PE. It affected the rest of our grade point average and was helpful to us. I'm just saying this. Sometimes we focus on the things we like to do. We like to be joyful, or we like it when people pray. But maybe we don't like to be thankful or find reasons to be thankful in our life. And it affects our whole spiritual grade point average, you might say. You see, sometimes we think we can do really good in one area and it won't affect the other area of our spiritual life. But if you are ignoring the Holy Spirit's guidance and direction in other areas of your life, then it's going to affect everything. When I was in school, we got a report card quarterly so that you could see how you're doing, so your parents could encourage you to modify your behavior in the next quarter with extra time at home with them. I think it's good for us to stop periodically. And without any spirit of condemnation, without any spirit of guilt, but it's good for us periodically to stop and say, Holy Spirit, how am I doing? Where do I need to change some in my life? What is it that I need to do that's going to bring more glory to you, that is going to make it so that I'm not quenching the Holy Spirit, stifling the Holy Spirit in any area of my life? And in this area of thanksgiving, if we're not careful, we have become so modified that our thanksgiving is determined by what we think God's done for us lately, instead of an expectation what God is going to continue to do in our lives. The Apostle Paul said, be thankful in all these situations. I want to talk to us in just a moment here about Luke chapter 17, where there was the 10 individuals that had leprosy. And that, I can't imagine a disease such as that at that time. It was a disease that not only, of course, affected your physical body. There was no hope. There was no medicine. There was no relief from that. But also, if you had leprosy, your life was basically over. You were, in one sense, the reality of a walking dead man. You couldn't interact with other people. You couldn't be at family gatherings. Society had pushed you out. You had to actually, if you got anywhere close to another individual, you had to cry out, unclean, unclean, to let them know, to stay away, stay back. And so what would happen is you found other individuals with the same situation, and you had to stick together just to survive. But your life really was over at that particular time. I can't imagine anything at that time that would be anything worse. And I'm sure that most of us in this room have a really hard time to really connect with something of that definition, just how bad that would have been. And the hope, there wasn't even hope of getting healed. There wasn't even a hope for medicine. There wasn't any hope for a change. But then they started hearing about this Jesus. And hope started to stir on the inside of them. They started to hear about this Jesus, and he comes close one day, and they start crying out, Jesus, have mercy on us. And the Bible says there in Luke chapter 17, verse 14, I believe it is, and Jesus tells them, go show yourself to the priest. He didn't touch him. He didn't pray for them. He didn't say any magical words over them. He just gave them some instruction. And the Bible says, as they started to obey or as they started to go, they were cleansed of their leprosy. I can't imagine that the immediate joy that that would bring into their life, that all of a sudden those open sores would just be all of a sudden healed up in front of, in their body, that they could look at one another and be able to see that there was a cleansing, there was a healing, a whole that went on in their lives, and that disease that once gave them their identity now was delivered from. What an incredible thing would go on. And amazing. I mean, that would you put that in the good category? That they'd gone from a very bad situation to a very good situation. And these 10 individuals that Jesus, without any restraint, without any question whether it would be God's will or not, without any question whether they'd been being good or not, without any question whether they deserved it or not, he was there to demonstrate that he was Jesus, anointed of God, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. And I'm so glad Jesus hasn't changed. But these 10, their lives were immediately transformed and changed. It was a good thing. But God wanted to take it. In a sense, he was willing to go from good to great. Let's start reading here in verse 15, if you would. Luke chapter 17, verse 15, it says, And one of them, oh, I pray that every one of you is a one of them. I pray that every one of you awakens today the fact that we were dead people just walking around, spiritually dead. Spiritually, we had no hope. Spiritually, we're separated from God. But then we came in contact with Jesus. Has anybody come in contact with Jesus in your life? And then you realize that situation that you couldn't save yourself. I was just talking with Dr. Mike this morning about that. We couldn't save ourselves. We couldn't be good enough. Like the Pharisee thought he was good enough. But folks, I want you to know we could never achieve our salvation in and of ourselves. There was no amount of sacrifices that we could give in. There's no amount of repentance that we could do it. No amount of penance that we could do to give it. But by the grace and the love and the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, we met Jesus and we became alive in him. And we were born again and we were set free in our life, even more than this man. But in a sense, at that day, at that moment, you were saved. I wonder, you know, that in one sense, that's the greatest thing that ever happened in your life. But I want you to know, God's not done with your life. We are not saved and just hanging out till we get to heaven. We are here to be going from glory to glory in our life, from faith to faith, from victory to victory in our lives. God continually knows what our future is and wants to demonstrate his goodness and his greatness in our life. But there's times that we need to pause and we need to step back and remember to give him thanks for what he has done, and in a sense, trusting him for what he's going to do in our lives. One of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, glorifying and praising and honoring God with a loud voice. And he laid face down at Jesus' feet, thanking him over and over and over and over again. When was the last time you just got down and just thank God you're saved? Just thanked him for his presence in your life. Just thanked him for a few moments. I call them Holy Ghost flashbacks. You know, some people that they've been on drugs or they've been in a terrible situation, they'll have these flashbacks. You know what? We need some Holy Ghost flashbacks. You remember that day that you got born again? I know it's been a while for some of us, but it's just like yesterday that you got born again. Do you remember that day that God spoke to your heart about a situation that it turned it around? Do you remember about that time that you thought you were broke and couldn't, and God supernaturally come up and did something in your life? Do you remember that day that you thought that your life was over and God showed up and he brought new life to you? I don't know what it is or what it was, but we need to have some Holy Ghost flashbacks. And we just say, God, thank you for being there. Thank you for your goodness and your mercy in my life. Thank you for saving me as a young man. Thank you, God, for the blessings you brought into my life. Thank you for the good wife that you've given to me and you blessed me with. Thank you for my family, Father God, that you bless. Thank you for the good church that you put me a part of and get to be the blessing of my life. Thank you, God, that those times that I remember when we didn't have milk in the refrigerator for my kids and that you provided for us and you made a way in my. When was the last time you just were overcome with some of those Holy Ghost flashbacks and you just paused and you started thanking God and you forgot about how excited you were and you got louder and louder and people maybe were looking at you. Maybe they don't remember the moment. Maybe they weren't there, but you can't hold in what you know God's done in your life. And they started to give thanks over and over to him. He was a Samaritan. I think it's interesting that it quickly brings out that he was an individual that according to their, I suppose you would say their religious people at the time would have a little expectation of this guy coming in. But he was a Samaritan. And then Jesus asked in verse 17, were not 10 of you cleansed? Where are the other 9? I think, wow. I'm glad every one of you is the one. But I pause and I think how many there are of the 9 people that God's touched their lives, but they got what they wanted from God and now they're getting off and doing their own thing. Now they don't have time for church because now God's taken provided for them. They were asking God for a job and now they don't have time to come to church because they got a job. They were asking God for health in their body and now they don't have time to come to church because they've got these things going on in their lives. Folks, I want to remind us that when God does something good in your life, we need to just keep keeping him first place in our life. And we need to keep following after him and be an example and saying, God, now that you've raised me up, now that you've saved me, now that you've forgiven me, now that you've empowered me, the Holy Spirit, what do you want to do with me? My life belongs to you now. And in a sense, this one came and he realized that not only was his life better, his life now belonged to God. It belonged to Jesus. Then I need to go and just tell him thanks. And the situation starts to go from good to great here. Listen to this. Was there not 9? And verse 18, was there no one found to return and to give thanks, to praise to God except this one foreigner? And Jesus says to him, get up and go on your way. Your faith, your personal trust in me and your confidence in God's power has restored your health. There's an understanding here that as the scripture unfolds, that there was the healing that took place, the cleansing of the leprosy that was in his body. But as he came and he fell down and he started giving thanks to Jesus, that there was a greater work that was about to be done. And he is made whole in his body. He is made complete in his body. That which God had started did even more than he had asked for along the way. Has God ever done that in your life? Where you've asked for some, I was just talking with someone this morning where they was believing God for one situation and God answered it and did even more in their family, in their lives. God is able to do more than you could ever think or imagine. So what do? If we can't think it, if we can't imagine it, we can thank him for it. Is there some area in your life, some situation where maybe God has made it better, but you're saying, God, I know that this isn't all that you want to do. I know that this isn't the completed plan of God. I know that you want to perfect that which you have begun to do in my life. Are you stirred up on the inside of you with an expectation? And in that expectation, there is an overflow of thanksgiving in your life, of what he desires to do supernaturally in and through you. You know, so often in our lives, as humans, we don't have the capacity to see everything that God can do, everything that he wants to do, but we can trust him along the way, folks. Turn to your neighbor and say, you can trust God. You can trust God. You can trust him. Even when you don't see how it's gonna work out, You can trust him. We've just got to learn to respond in faith, and in that faith, an attitude of thanksgiving to God. Well, I can't see how it's going to work out, God, but I'm going to trust you. Lord, there's this area of my life that I not only need the goodness of God to touch it, I need the miracle power of God to restore this in my life. I need, doesn't the Bible talk about the God of restoration somewhere? To restore something. You know, when we first looked at this facility, and it was not in the shape that it is now, a lot of the things that were in here were taken out. It hadn't been painted for probably, I don't know, 20 years maybe or something like that. And there was things that were just, and we needed to restore this building. It didn't mean that we're going to tear it down and build something new. We were going to take what was and we were going to make it better. We were going to restore it as it was. And folks, I want you to know that when God works in your life, maybe there's some areas that the adversary has touched. Maybe there's some areas where there's been some demonic attacks. Maybe there's just been some area where you've got some situations that you made some wrong. Has anybody ever made a wrong choice and decision before in your life and it didn't turn out like you thought it was? You got your hands in there and you were gonna fix it. You were gonna make it better. And what you did is you made it worse along the way. That's a great time for us to step back and say, Jesus, I need the miracle power of restoration at work in this situation. I need the miracle power of just not your goodness to stop it from getting any worse. I need you to restore it so it's obvious what you can do along the way. I haven't done it for quite some time, but one of the hobbies I used to have was to restore furniture. I would take a piece of furniture and strip down the old varnishes and sand down the old wood there that was there and smooth it out. And maybe if there was a couple minor adjustments that needed to be fixed on it, and then I would restore it. I would put the new varnishes on it and put the new waxes on it. And some of them I would put tongue oil on it where you had to rub it all in along the way and to be able to see it finished at the end. It was a restored piece of furniture that could be used once again. Folks, I want you to know that God is not repurposing your life. He's restoring your life. He's not trying to make you into something that you're not. He's making you into something that he originally created you on purpose for. And when we have an attitude of faith and thanksgiving that things are better, but they're going to go to great in God, that we can trust the Lord to do his work in us, that it is amazing, that keeps us from going and doing the crazy. It keeps us from giving up on God and helps us so that we keep walking in the Lord's grace in our life. This man did because of in his heart, came back and worshiped Jesus and gave him thanks, released the spiritual principle that reveals to us that God can go from good to great in our lives. Now we as individuals, we don't have to just kind of happen upon this truth. We see it here. May the Holy Spirit right now be stirring some area in your life where he's saying, God's done good, but he wants to do great. Will you thank him for it in the space between here and there? Will you thank him that he's able to do it? Will you trust that God began a good work and he is able to complete it in your life? Will you trust him so that it's not just better than it was, but that it starts to go to a great? Can you imagine for just a moment when the one caught up with the nine? Can you imagine? Because they're cleansed, but they probably still missing some toes. Maybe some areas of their feet maybe have been ate away because of, so they're moving along, but they're thankful that they don't have the pain that they used to have, but they're not moving very fast. But all of a sudden they hear this dude running up behind them. I'm saying running behind them. He's running up behind them and say, guys, look what just happened to me. Look what God did in my life. I got all my toes back. I got all my fingers back. I got my ears back. I got my nose back. And they're looking at him thinking, we're glad that we're not what we were. But it's an amazing what God can restore us to be. That he can bring us back. That he can complete what is lacking in our life. And part of the way that we release that, how did it happen in this man? Because he went and gave thanks. He paused. He took the time. Be thankful what had happened. But in that, Jesus revealed to him, hey, there's even more that God wants to do in your life. You can just write this scripture down. We're quickly running out of time this morning. But this scripture in Psalm 138, verse 8. Now, I really encourage you as we're going through our messages for you to pick and say, Holy Spirit, give me at least one message, or give me one scripture, or give me a phrase that was said so that I can be meditating on the word, so that I'm taking it from beyond just a sermon that was preached by a guy. It's a message that I'm receiving in my heart by the Holy Spirit. Psalm 138, verse 8 says, the Lord will perfect or complete that which concerns me. The Lord will perfect or complete that which concerns me. I want you to know, if the Lord was wanting to do that in the physical body of that one gentleman that had leprosy, he's wanting it to do it in every area of our lives. That's a great verse for you to be able just to start to hold on to. The Bible says the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. That is all taking away. Jesus said, I have come to give you life, and that life more abundantly. That's restoration in our life. That's restoring fellowship with God. That's restoring his original plan of how he created us and why he created us. I like one translation reads it this way: the Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. If we're people of faith and thanksgiving, it's amazing. We don't have to see how God's going to do it. We don't have to see it all working out just right before us. But we can say, I've got confidence in God's ability that he's going to complete, perfect, or fulfill the very purpose of my existence. That's pretty good stuff, God, folks, to grab a hold of right there. To realize that no matter how much the enemy tries, no matter how many problems you got around you, maybe the enemy is attacking you. Maybe life, maybe it's physical, maybe it's financial. Maybe you've got people that hate you, enemies that hate you. Maybe you got some friends that hate you. I don't know. There's some folks that say they're friends, but you kind of wonder the way they treat you when you're not around. But it's good to know that God never changes, that he's always there to bring his will in your life to pass. Do you trust him to do that? Do you believe it? Are you praying like it? You know, Romans chapter 8, verses 26 through 28, the Apostle Paul, you know, the latter part of that, verse 28, we like that God is able to work all things together for his good in our life. We like that verse. But the reality is, folks, that the verses before that talk about praying in partnership with the Holy Spirit, that we need the help of the interceder, the Holy Spirit. He is the one that is our helper, that is sent to help us, because in our weakness, the Bible says. What is your weakness when it comes to prayer? Well, some people say, well, my weakness is I have a hard time staying awake. Well, my weakness is that my mind starts to drift. Folks, those aren't the weaknesses he's talking about here. The weakness that we have is with our natural capacity, we are not able to know all that God wants to do and how he wants to do it. We're limited to know what the will of God. We've got some good ideas, and we've got a lot of Christians that are, I think, individuals. I think God should do it this way, and I think God should do it that way. And if I was God, I would do it this way. But folks, what we really need are some people that are not I thinkers, but there are I trust people. I trust God that's gonna work all things together for good. I trust him, but I still have to pray. All things don't work together for good if we're not doing the verses right before that. If we're not people of prayer, not just prayer, prayer that is partnered together with the Holy Spirit's leading. You turn to your neighbor and say, you need help. You need help. You need help. Because you need help when it comes to prayer. Why is that? Because if we're not careful, we just pray out of our emotions. We pray out of our logic. I think it's interesting, as I was listening to a gentleman this week, he was talking that one of the major reasons for atheists, especially in the United States, one of the major reasons for atheists is not because of scientific arguments, it's because of an emotional situation. Where if you'll talk to him, you'll listen to him, somewhere along the line, they prayed and God didn't do what they asked. And since they prayed and God didn't do what they think God should have done, therefore there must not be a God. They prayed for a child, a sister, a brother, a mother that was sick, and they died. And they died, so therefore, God didn't answer my prayer, so there must not be a God. An emotional atheist along the way. Why do I share that with us? Because folks, our emotions can be so overpowering in our life. And we have to be careful that we don't allow what we see and feel to have more influence on our life than our faith in God along the way. I'm not asking us to come up with some religious kind of cliche to be able to throw in the face of someone who's had a devastation in their life. But what I am saying is we've got to trust God no matter what happens in our life. We look at the world around us. What in the world is going on out there? But really, that's the wrong question. The real question is, what in the Word is going on in here? Because that's what's going to transform what's going on in the world around us. I want to encourage us today to understand that you have a good God that wants to do good things in your life. But He is so good that He wants to take it to great, to demonstrate His grace in us as individuals. But as much as He wants to do His part, He needs us to do our part. And our part is to trust Him. Our part is to have faith in Him. Our part is that we are at a point that we give thanks to Him for what He has done with Holy Ghost flashbacks of His goodness in our life. But we're also saying, God, you're not done yet. We believe that you're able to still do even greater things, that you are the way maker in my life, and that we trust you to be able to go through whatever comes our way in the days ahead, that we believe that you're a God that's able to bring it to pass. He is the God of completion. And here it is, folks. You listening? None of you are perfect yet. None of you are perfect yet. But I'm thankful that God's still working in your life. I'm thankful that inside of this church, that there are people that God's done some good stuff in your life, but He's got some great stuff He wants to do through your life. And that if you'll just keep following after Him, if you'll just keep walking by faith and not by sight, if you'll just keep thanking Him, God, I know that it doesn't look good on the outside, but I know on the inside what you're desiring to do, and you're gonna work all things together for good in my life. I'm just so thankful that you're a God that hears and answers prayer, and that the Holy Spirit has been sent to help me. And you're going to intercede through me. You're going to walk through me in this situation, that even though I don't know how it's all going to work out, I am almost uncontainable with the excitement of what you can do in this day and in this age, and what you're going to perform through my life and in this church, that you are the God that's not finished with my life and what you can do in my life. And I can trust you. I can trust you. I can trust you even when I can't see what's going on. I can trust you. I can trust you even when it looks like it's getting worse. I can trust you. And maybe at those moments when it's the darkest is a good time for you to have a Holy Spirit flashback of just how good God has been. And if He could do that, if He could go from bad to good, He can go from good to great in your life, because He still is the miracle-working God. Amen? Close your eyes for just a moment, if you would, please. There's nothing spiritual about closing your eyes. It's not that moment that the Holy Spirit then starts to work, but it just helps us to draw our focus and our attention inward for just a moment. How's your spiritual grade point average going? How are you doing in some of these areas? I'm not asking what others have done to you. I'm not asking you how you feel. I'm saying, are you being a doer of the word? Is there some area that you need to step it up? That this would be just a pause moment. This is your quarterly report card. Or you're just saying, these are some areas, God, I'm thankful for what you have done through me and taught me, but these are some areas that I still need to improve on. Because you really want to please the Lord. Because you really want to be that example. Maybe there's some area in your life that the Holy Spirit right now is just tapping you on the shoulder and you just need to say yes. In a sense of obedience, that I'm going to work on that. But I need your help, Lord. I need your help. Holy Spirit, I just thank you for your presence. Lord, all of us need to have a sense of repentance about us, that we're quick to change the directions that we're going, quick to change our thoughts to line up with your thoughts, if necessary, to even modify our beliefs so that they are more in line with yours. But today, I'm not asking for a response to a sermon, but I'm asking Holy Spirit, that you would work in every single one of our lives, because there's greater things that need to be done in our city. And it's going to happen through a church, through individuals that are excited about following you in faith and are thankful that you to know that you've gone before us. You've made a way where there was no way. You've opened doors that no man can shut. You've already prepared for us victory over assaults and attacks of the adversary. You've given us the physical strength to be able to go forward and to do the work and the ministry you've called us to. You brought healing to our bodies, peace to our mind, resources into our lives. Lord, we just thank you that as we're going forward, thank you for the good things that you have done. But God, in our day, we're asking for greater things to be done, so that you will be glorified and many will be brought into the kingdom. Many will be brought to the saving knowledge of Jesus in their life. That we be not just one of the 10 that was cleansed, but may we be the Jesus in the situation, where we are the ones bringing help and wholeness and miraculous miracles to people that we come into contact with. May we go from being a good church attender to being a great messenger of the gospel in this day and age and following after you. Holy Spirit, only you can do that in our lives. As pastor, specifically, I ask, may the fire of the Spirit stir us, cleanse us, and reveal Christ in us. In Jesus' name. Amen. When you came in this morning, you should have received from one of the youth the elements for communion. This time of the year, especially as we reflect on our Lord Jesus Christ and the work he did for us, it's just a good reminder that from the cradle to the cross, that he was demonstrating and displaying the love of the Father God. And so we just pause for just a moment and remind ourselves that this is a demonstration of the love of God in our life, a display of his love. But the purpose for Jesus displaying his love so that that love could be displayed in our lives. From the cradle of our heart, where that love of God has to abide, to living the crucified life of following after Christ in our life. Paul writes to the church in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and says, "For I received from the Lord that which also I delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took the bread, and when he had given thanks," there it is again, given thanks, "he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is offered for you.'" That was in advance. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, also, he took the cup, and after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat the bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. That death is a demonstration of the love of God. We oftentimes stop there. But if we believe that much, do you believe that much? Do you believe that much? Let's read the next few verses like we believe them also. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself, then so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For whoever eats and drinks without discerning the Lord's body, eats and drinks judgment upon himself. That's why some of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judge ourselves, we will not be judged. It's pretty sobering. Sometimes we just kind of buzz over that. Maybe we need to pause for just a moment. Again, not with any sense of guilt or condemnation. But maybe there's some areas we need to do some adjustment. Charles Spurgeon said, if we really love Jesus the way we say we do, we would also love his body, one another. Discerning the Lord's body is not only a revelation and an understanding of the physical body, the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ, and his blood that was shed for us and placed in the mercy seat, but it's also this body called the church, which is his body also. How we treat one another, how we love one another, how we pray for one another, how we really care for one another. It's moments like this we need to pause. Do we believe what we just read? And if we do, then it should affect the way we treat one another, not just the way that we say we love Jesus. Lord, we need revelation. We need the voice of the Holy Spirit to speak to us. You didn't tell us to condemn one another. You didn't tell us to point out one another's errors in this particular portion of Scripture. You said for us to pause, judge ourselves, so that we wouldn't be judged. We would receive forgiveness, repentance, but also a new way of living. Lord, forgive us for the way we've treated your body at times. Forgive us for the way we've talked about fellow believers. Forgive us for turning the other way when we've seen a need. Forgive us for being so consumed with ourself that we didn't have time to serve others. So Lord, help us not to be Christians that think things should be done different, but believers that are loving others until they are different. Thank you for your patience in our lives. Lord, as we receive these elements today, we release our faith. We thank you the blood of Jesus has cleansed us and forgiven us. We thank you for the body of Christ that was broken, that by Jesus' stripes we have been healed. And we thank you, Lord, for the therapeutic work of the Holy Spirit in our church to bring wholeness and healing in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead and receive the bread that represents, of course, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, both physically and spiritually. That we become in Christ. It changes our life. But when we're in Christ, we're also in his church, the body of Christ also. Lord, help us have understanding in this, in Jesus' name. The cup reminds us of the cup of sacrifice that Jesus was willing to go through for us, but also the cup of blessing that has been to us. To Jesus, it was a sacrifice. To us, it's a blessing. May we live our life that we're willing to sacrifice so others will be blessed. as we follow after the example of Jesus in our life. Holy Spirit, we give our lives totally over to you. Do whatever you want, however you want, whenever you want, to touch whoever you want through our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. I ask you to stay just a few moments, find someone, encourage them. Maybe you need to come to the altar for a few moments and just have a few extra moments with the Lord or right where you are, I don't know. But let's not just rush out the door. Let's take a few moments, encourage one another. We've just been in an atmosphere where the presence of the Lord is changing hearts and lives. And let's reinforce it by looking at someone and let them know what God's doing in them. You can see it on their face. God bless you. We love you. And we'll see you on Wednesday night.